Welcome everyone to my presentation. My name is Marcin Zajączkowski, and I will be talking about interesting techniques and mechanisms of Spock. Before I start, a few words about me. I specialize in automatic testing and things related to code quality. In addition, I'm an enthusiast of widely defined concurrency and continuous delivery. Besides, I'm an open source project author and contributor, trainer and blogger. For a living, with a group of passionate geeks, I lead a small software house, Codarte, which is targeted at clients who care about their quality. Two interesting companies I cooperate with, of course, Codarte, and in addition, Bottega IT Solutions, for which I conduct trainings. In case of questions, feel free to ask them during the presentation. Just get my attention in some possible way. What you could expect during the presentation? Okay, I think we have a problem, but I will try to figure out why. Okay, so it was the first slide, the second slide, the third slide, and here we are. Agenda. First of all, there will be no introduction to Spock. I assume that you already know Spock and you just want to learn it more. The presentation is composed as a set of more advanced techniques and mechanisms, which in my opinion are worth to mention. There will be also the dark side of Spock, places which are not very intuitive and where it is easy to go wrong. I have the primary goal for today. I would like everyone to get at least one new thing out of this presentation. I hope to achieve that, but in the situation, if you know everything, please come to me after the presentation. I would like to shake your hand and exchange contact details. Let's start with one interesting phenomenon, synergy. I will explain by example. And do you know those guys? Yes, those are Planeteers, a group of five young people from the TV series broadcast in the 90s. Planeteers were equipped with magic rings, controlling four elements of nature and the element of heart. With those rings, they were able to protect the Earth from pollution and disaster. However, under severe threat, they could combine their powers and summon someone else. Who knows, can song with the computer? Do you remember that catchy tune? It's Captain Hero, really powerful guy with great strength and flight abilities. And he's the result of five ring powers combined together, but he can achieve much more than Planeteers with their rings separately. That's synergy. Together we have attained more. And I would risk a statement that in the case of Groovy and Spock, the situation is similar. Groovy is a very powerful language, offering developers much more than Java. Spock leverages Groovy and adds its own magic to write compact and nice-looking specifications. And on the other hand, Groovy, I heard the statement that Spock is a Trojan horse for Groovy, because this is the entry point, and you learn Groovy while writing tests with Spock. Later you can discover that you can write some DSLs, maybe implement custom logic to be able to modify it by the user. And later you discover Grace, Griffon, and there is idea in your head that you can use it also for production code. And after that, it's very hard to get back to Java and to those verbal structures which we need to write in Java. In my humble opinion, Spock and Groovy, Spock is the best testing framework for Java and Groovy, which exists nowadays. It's easy to understand, but there are many interesting nooks and crannies, and some of them I would like to present to you today. Let's start with conditional test execution. And sometimes we may need to execute our test in the situation when some conditions are or are not met. We have two extensions available in Spock, requires and ignore if, and we can provide custom logic, which will be checked if given condition is met. And here we have example when we have tests which are executed, should be executed only in a local company network intranet where some external services are available. In other case, it doesn't make sense to run it from home because they will fail, and we don't need that problem. That method is placed in the same class as the tests, but it can be moved to some util class, to trait, it doesn't matter. It's worth to remember that due to delegation logic implemented under the hood, it is required to put import statement, even if it is in the same class, to prevent missing method exception at runtime. For more complex, maybe time-consuming operations which are executed multiple times, we can use memoist to get in a more cache. Very often, those extensions are used to get system properties or environment variables in our test. We can use native methods from JDK, but starting with Spock 1.0, it can be simplified. We have additional classes like operating system, which provides very convenient methods to check if we are running on Linux, Mac, or maybe something else. And in addition, we have JVM class, which allows us to check if, for example, we are on JVM, which is Java 8 compatible. So no more getting properties and parsing the output to determine that those things. It's implemented, it's embedded into Spock classes that can be reused. However, it's all very well, but there is one important issue or limitation of that construction in ignore-if. If you already use that approach, maybe you could tell me what's the problem. Okay. For me, there's problem with code completion. You need to know it by heart that there is jvm.java8-compatible and other methods, and it can be problematic because you can fail at runtime because of some typo or different method name. What can we do? Internally, OS and the JVM are delegated to precondition context class, which provides those fields, and because the execution is delegated to those class, so everything works at runtime. However, it's not available for IDE because we cannot use delegates to annotation, which is designed only for methods. Here we have annotation, so we cannot use that another annotation to tell IDE that precondition context should be resolved as a delegate. Luckily, we can use a workaround. We can declare precondition context as a field. We can create instance explicitly, and we can use it explicitly in this execution. Thanks to that, IDE will know that we have precondition context, and we'll have nice-looking completion and warnings about unknown values. However, I would like to put it to as a pull request to Spock, but I have no idea what good names would be good. Using a Spock convention, it should be instance, but instance here could be not very readable for users. So if you have a good idea how to name it, please come to me after the presentation, tweet to me, mail to me, etc. and thanks in advance. Okay, let's move to initialization cleanup. Sometimes we have resources which we need to prepare before for one particular test, and we don't want to expose them to the whole specification. In that case, we can use setup and cleanup blocks. While setup is just an alias for given, cleanup is more specific because Spock guarantees that it will be executed even in the situation when there was an exception thrown in then or when block. So it's very useful for cleanup operations. Once I was working with correlation ID propagation across threads, and I came up with the situation like here that I wanted to extract this task which is submitted to execution service, to connection thread pool. And I did something like that, and I assumed that it will work as expected. What do you think about that example? Will it work or not? Unfortunately not, and it fails with null returned from get method. After some digging, I figured out that the issue is that initially Groovy closure was implementing just runnable interface. Sometime after, the callable interface was added to be implemented by closure class, but for backward compatibility reasons, when there is a method execution like submit which takes runnable or callable, for backward compatibility, runnable method variant is used. So in that case, we call submit with runnable, and get just does not return anything, so we have null. What we can do to avoid that? We could create anonymous callable class instance, but it's not very groovy, and we can do something better. We can leverage the fact that we can use map to encode it into callable. In that case, we have no runnable, so submit has no choice to call a variant with callable argument. Maybe it's not. It could be strange looking for people not people which are not familiar with that construction, but it works and can be used as a workaround for mentioned issue. Sometimes we can have resources which are should be initialized before all tests and cleaned up after all tests. We can use before spec and cleanup spec blocks, but it's quite verbose. Of course, we can try to inline a method resource initialization, but with cleanup, it's not so easy to make it inline. Luckily, there is auto cleanup extension, which clean up resource at the end of its lifetime. So for shared fields, it will be at the end of all execution of all tests. For instance field, it will be after every test. It's nice, and in addition, when we are dealing with third-party library, which we do not control, we can even override the method which will be called at the end of lifetime. So we can adjust it to some other classes which has release method instead of close. However, sometimes we have more complex cases where auto cleanup is not enough and we need to do something more. And starting with Spock 1.0, there is, in addition to support for native setup and cleanup methods, there is support for before and after annotations from JUnit. It's nice because it can be mixed together even through class hierarchy, which is useful for testing framework builds on top of Spock, like in Grace or Griffon. And in addition, it can be used from threads. But first, take a look at the example how Very often in our project, we have integration tests configured. We have base integration test spec, which set up basic Spring context, maybe set test profile in Spock, and provides basic context. Later we have a base database specification, which adds database configuration, and for example, initialize database connection, maybe expose entity manager, so on. Thanks to that, and database classes can just extend base database specification, and they have access to entity manager and can do operation on it. There is no problem, there's no infrastructure in those classes to initialize Spring context and so on. Everything is done in those base classes. Everything is fine, but we may need to create another type of integration test, like with WireMock, when we need to set up WireMock before tests and shut down it after all tests. Similar pattern can be used, but that could be a requirement that we need both database tests and WireMock tests. In that case, there is no multiple inheritance in Java, so it's problematic to combine those two superclasses together, and we would need to refactor it somehow. The situation can be even worse when we have a requirement to mix more classes and have integration tests with database, ActiveMQ, and WireMock, and it's clearly visible that class hierarchy does not scale that way. What we can do instead? Groovy 2.3 introduced traits. In simplification, it can be treated as an interface from Java 8 with default methods, but it's stateful. Its statefulness is very important in case of Spock and integration tests, because we can just create trait which has a static field DB connection, and that field can be initialized, can be cleaned up, and after that, it's enough to just implement or apply trait on a given class, and that test can just call, use that field DB connection, DB manager, or DAO from Spring data, and it can execute methods. There is no infrastructure here, so we have situations similar to those with superclasses, but with trait, there is no inheritance involved, so there is no problem with having database trait and WireMock trait and another trait applied on given class. Thanks to that, we can achieve nice-looking implementation of integration tests without inheritance involved. Of course, we could write custom Spock extension or JUnit rule to do the same, like for WireMock. But in case we have some custom logic, we usually do not want to do that because traits are much easier to write. So in simple cases, traits are more useful to use. Unfortunately, nothing is perfect, and due to implementation issues or implementation approach in traits, please remember that there is no inheritance involved. Traits are implemented as inner class created in given class, so the fields from traits are not available directly in test class. There is getter and setter, which delegates to that inner class, and because of that, there is no simple way to get access to annotations put on given fields, on fields defined in trait. So we cannot, if we have auto cleanup or shared annotation put on field in a trait, Spock currently does not support getting those annotations, and we cannot use those features. We need to do something else, like instead of auto cleanup, we can use cleanup spec method to do that. So it's worth to remember to not try to use it because it doesn't work currently. Any questions so far? No. Okay. So let's move to parameterized tests, one of the fields at which Spock excels. There is built-in support with where keyword, And in addition, and together with Synthetic Sugar for table-like data formatting, it completely outclasses support for parameterized tests available in pure JUnit. We can use Unreal annotation and placeholders put in a method name to achieve nice-looking BDD-like reports. It works fine, but there is for sometimes Spock reports are used like BDD reports are designed for so-called business people, and it could be problematic. Correctness false, correctness true. It doesn't look good, and maybe we could do something more. Luckily, yes, we could leverage the fact that we have Unreal annotation can take additional parameter, which is a text which will be used in a report for given test. In addition, we can provide additional variable which is not used in our test; it's just for reporting purpose. Thanks to that, we have best of both worlds because we have social security number 123 should be invalid. Sounds very good. For business people, it will be fine. And on the other hand, we have still very readable for developers test name. Should validate social security correctness. So both developers and business people are satisfied. And the nice bonus is that when we are using text in Unreal annotation, we have code completion for placeholders available in IntelliJ IDE. Of course, data tables are fine, but for some complicated cases, it is useful to use data providers and data pipes to provide the data directly to our variables. It can be used to get data from external sources like CSV file, SQL database, or for example from spreadsheet using Apache POI. But there is one thing which I personally don't like in a parameterized test in Spock. What don't you like in parameterized test in Spock? Everything. Okay, maybe I'm specific. I write a lot of tests in Spock, maybe because of that, but I think that Unreal is boring. Unreal is not enabled by default, so I need to put Unreal on every test which should be parameterized. To mitigate the problem, I can use Unreal at the class level. Thanks to that, all parameterized tests in a given specification will be unrolled automatically. Nice. And there is even no side effect. So if we have two parameterized tests and there is one not parameterized test, it doesn't matter. But I wanted to get more. So I created Spock Global Unroll extension, which enables automatic unrolling of parameterized tests in the whole project. It's a global extension, so it is enough to just put it on a class path. And after that, all parameterized tests in the whole project will be unrolled. No need to use unroll annotation anymore, just for enabling unrolling. If for some reason we would need to disable unrolling for some particular class, we can use roll annotation or disable global unroll annotation, and for that given class, an automatic unrolling will be suppressed. The nice thing is that it will disable only automatic unrolling. So if we have that roll annotation, but we explicitly put unroll annotation on one of the tests, it will be unrolled as before. Maybe any additional questions to the material we covered? If not, let's move on to mocking. There is nice syntax in Spock to stub method execution in Spock. We can use it also for consecutive calls. It is just enough to use a shift operator more than once.
or we can use that operator and use a list. It can be mixed together, and for example, if we need to simulate a throwing exception in a given in a method execution on stub, we can just use closure and provide the exception. However, that exception could be enhanced somehow. Do you have idea what we can, what is missing, what could be missing in that exception? Okay, there was an answer, message. And yeah, in general, it's very important, especially for illegal argument exception, to get know what input argument caused the problem. Because illegal argument exception, okay, but what was the reason? And to do that, we may need to get input parameter which the method was executed with and use it in the closure. Luckily, Spock provides a default argument to the closure which is used, which contains an array of input arguments. So in our case, we can just take the first element of that array to return the argument which was used. Very often, the problem which can be spotted very often is the fact that even for one input argument, we cannot use just it, because even then there is an array of input parameters, so we always have to use the first argument from the collection. Alternatively, we could use named parameters. If we provide those parameters in closure, Spock will fill we will fill those parameters with proper values, so we will get item which was used here. But bear in mind that in case, even in the situation when there is three parameters and we need just one, we need to specify all the parameters which are used in the method signature. In other case, we'll get Groovy cast exception. And one more warning. In the situation you have one argument and it's the list, Spock does not know if we want to get that argument as a list or we want to get a list of input arguments. And in that case, named parameters cannot be used. Just a collection with input arguments. And a small puzzle. We have stubbing. And we have interaction verification for the same method. And the question is, will it work as expected? No. And probably it's the problem which everyone who tries to stub with Spock encounter. Problem is that under the hood, stubbing and interaction verification is treated, is memorized, and two separate things. And when Spock evaluates operation on given stub, it just takes the first matching one and ignores the rest. So as a result, verification will pass, but this stubbing will be ignored, so save will return null. So it's usually not what we expect. Currently, it is very detailed. There is a big warning in documentation: do not do that. But I remember, a few years ago, it was hard to find the reason because in documentation there was no information about that. So I have idea to write a pull request to Spock to check that situations at runtime and throw exception when we try to do something like that. However, as a workaround, we could use interaction verification as stubbing in the same line. It doesn't look good, but in general, in that case, you need to think about the design of your test, because stubbing is usually used for methods which return an argument and a value. Interaction verification very often is used for void methods. So in many cases, it is not needed to do both stubbing and interaction verification for the same method execution. So maybe you overspecify the test and it can be simplified to have just one of those things in the test. Verification in order. Sometimes we need to check if given two operations on a mock were executed in particular order. Here we have saving order, and later we send notification to client. It would be good to have order saved first, and later the notification should be sent. Unfortunately, in that situation, Spock will evaluate the then block at the end of this block, so the order is not taken into account. To make it relevant, we need to separate then block, split it into two then blocks, and then the first block will be evaluated, the second block will be evaluated, and the order will be taken into account. However, please pay attention to end label. It's very useful to improve test readability and to have nice looking reports, but it's just for documentation purpose. It doesn't impact on the way how Spock evaluate this then block. So in that case, order will not be taken into account. And one more thing, it's that case is very simplified. In a real life application, when we call a save order method on entity manager, DO, or something like that, that operation is only scheduled to be performed. And the saving in the database is performed when the transaction is finished. So in that case, even if you have those methods executed in order, a send notification could be sent, and after that, on commit, the transaction will be rolled back due to some errors. In that cases, it's usually good to use transaction-bound events, which will schedule send notification operation just after the transaction is correctly committed. And it can be tested in integration tests with, for example, Spring and Spock. Argument matchers. Spring provides a lot of different argument matchers, from simple one to more complicated, like if the type is okay or something is not null. But I would like to focus on argument matching with custom logic. In Mockito, it can be done, but it's more verbose. In Spock, we just need to provide a closure, and we can get input argument and do an operation we want on that object. We can take a field from that object, we can call some other method to verify if the input argument satisfies us as in given verification, interaction verification. It can be used for multiple fields, and in addition, we can use the same matchers for stubbing, not only for argument verification. In Spock, we have a few different ways how Spock, how stubs or mocks can be created. We have Groovy way, which is nice. We have dev on the left side, but for IDE it's not a problem. Type is inferred, and IDE knows that we expect from the DAO, and we have code completion, which works correctly. But it can be less readable for Java newcomers, which expect to have type on the left. So we can, on the other hand, on the other end of the spectrum, you have Java way, which is, well, it's Java, so it's very verbose. And we have type specified on the left and on the right. There is the third way, shorter Java way, but there is one problem. When you try to use that in IDE, you have warning that, you developer, you try to assign object to some other type. It's bad. We could ignore them, those warnings, but it's very often it's a bad idea to ignore warnings. As explained in broken Windows theory, it can provide you to a situation when you start ignoring warnings which are important. Of course, it can be disabled by for a given class, but once when I was preparing my Spock training session, I take code and did modification, and in current master, in current snapshot, there is my change merged. So starting with Spock 1.0, when released, you will have access to that construction, and there is no warning in IDE anymore. Default response for a stopped calls. It's a feature which allows you to, it's Spock, the same as Mockito, has a lenient approach to unstop method calls on stops. It's in contrast to EasyMock, which in the situation when you try to call method which was not declared and a method which could be called, you will get exception. In case of Mockito and Spock, you will get some default neutral value like zero, empty collection, maybe empty object. It's very handy, especially when you cope with the code which was written by someone else and you just try to write tests for some overly complicated code, because for the code developed with TDD, it should be not required to have those combinations. However, it can be problematic. Let's take a look at the small example. We have interface with a method returning optional. And this is test which verifies that we can just call unstop method on that interface. And we expect no exception to be thrown. And question is, will it pass? I see you are confused. I would expect that yes. And the first time I thought that, unfortunately, I failed. Or the execution failed, and I was wrong because cannot create mocked for class optional. It's because optional is final. It's okay, but it shouldn't be a problem. Of course, we can enhance implementation in Spock to support the situation and return just null, but to work with Spock 1.0, we can apply some workarounds. The first possible workaround is to leverage the fact that by default, empty or dummy response factor is used for unstopped method execution. It returns default values, but it can be changed on demand. So to do that, we can, when more stop is created, we can pass a map with default response argument and pass some other factor for responses, here zero or null response. In that case, we tell Spock, do not try to do anything fancy with that unstop method execution. Just return null, zero, and whatever will be fine. And thanks to that, it will work. However, there is a simpler solution for that. We can leverage the fact that by default, empty or dummy response factor is used just for stops, for mocks and spies. By default, zero or null response is used. So the simple way is to replace stop with mock, and we have a workaround for our problem. However, if we have code, we have many method execution in so-called legacy code, when we would like to have not null written for optional, but for example empty optional, it could be useful. What we can do to do that? We can create so-called custom default response for our stopped calls. Yeah, and for example, provides support for Java 8 types, which currently are not supported by Spock. To do that, it is only required to implement one interface, iDefaultResponse, and in response method, check if given return type is optional. If yes, return default value. So empty optional, completed future for completable futures, and for example, for date, so some default date. In the situation when it's not from Java 8, written type is not from Java 8, we can delegate execution to default empty or dummy response to take care of our other cases. We can use that response factor like before with default response argument, map with that argument, and it will work. In some cases, when we have multiple calls for a given method, it's quite long to call it every time, so we can introduce util method to just create stub, which by default will return those values for Java 8 objects. And please take pay attention to situation when we have is present, that in that case, it's not enough to call result save operation is present, because for null, result as a null, it would return true. What is not what we need? In that case, we need to explicitly equal it to false. Sometimes it can be problematic and make your assertion not effective as you would expect. In some cases, when we spy on real objects, we can need to call a real method. In that case, we can use call real method method from Spock. And the nice thing is that there is this method takes care of passing arguments, input arguments, which were originally used to call our method. So we don't need to take it with all arguments and pass it here, because we just call this method. Of course, when we need to modify input arguments, we can use a modified version of that method and pass custom arguments as required. Maybe any question? Okay, so miscellaneous, or rather assertions. You know for sure that assertions in Groovy are very meaningful. And as far as you remember, they were originally implemented for Spock. They were later backported to Groovy. And currently, they are indispensable part of Groovy world. It's a very powerful feature. In Spock, additionally, we have an ability to not assert keyword is optional when we use then or expect block. So we can skip it, and the Spock will try to evaluate every line which is not void method execution. It's very useful. However, it could be confusing, because sometimes assert keyword is mandatory in Spock. The first case when assert keyword is mandatory is assertion or assertions which were extracted to a separate method. For example, to be reused across tests. In that case, assert keyword is important to make that assertion work. Similar situation is so-called guard assertions, which are used in a given block to verify that especially in integration tests, if, for example, number of elements in database is equal to what we expect, to verify input state of the system in integration tests. Similar situation is within closure. And I personally saw many multiple broken tests like those tests, and I have to admit that I even wrote one test that was broken for some time until I discovered that. And for me, it's very dangerous situation. You have false sense of security, that you have assertions that test something, and in fact, they don't test anything. I heard from someone a nice proverb that you should not trust a test, in that case, assertion, that you haven't seen failing. So in that case, especially when you have assertions in so different places, it's good to write an assertion in the way that it will fail, that it fails to verify that that assertion worked as expected. And in that case, mutation testing would be useful to be used, but unfortunately, there is no implementation of mutation testing for Groovy, so we cannot easily verify in other way that assertion will work as expected, only to do it manually. There could be even better assertions in Spock, because in this example, when we get null object here and call a method getter sex on that object, we'll get just null pointer exception. It can be problematic when we have a long, complex expression in assert to find out when what is wrong when there's problem with data. We could use safe navigation operator, and it works fine. We see that here is the problem, but we in Spock 1.1 there is a nice pull request merge that will render null pointer in the assertion itself. You may ask when Spock 1.1 will be released, and it's a very good question. But luckily, the situation is not as hopeless as you might think, because in the previous 2 weeks, there was several pull requests merged to Spock. Yesterday, at the Hacker Garden, a group of 8 people came together, and we were reviewing pull requests, creating some new pull requests, updating documentation, and Rob Fletcher, one of the current contributors, committers to Spock, declared to have Spock 1.1 with those changes released within a week or two. In addition, could be even better, because a few days ago I created a pull request to Spock, which implements automatic releasing of Spock from Travis to Maven Central. Thanks to that, when merged, hopefully in the foreseeable future it will be possible, then after your pull request will be merged to master, the new version will be released, probably the beta version, but still, released named version will be released to Maven Central, and your feature after merge to master will be available within minutes from Maven Central. So it's much better than snapshots, and I work on convincing Soren and Rob to make it merge to have almost continuous delivery from Travis to Maven Central of Spock. So hopefully it will be possible, and I hope that it will improve the, it will make a feedback loop shorten, and your features as people who could create pull requests will be possible to get into real released version within faster than today. Okay, do you remember about my goal? In case you find something interesting during the presentation, you may talk to me after the presentation, write me an email, tweet, and so on. Let's sum up the presentation. Writing tests shouldn't be a name in itself. It's just the way to write more reliable and maintainable software. Developers' time is expensive, so it's wise to use the best available tools and to know them well, to be able to leverage the strong points, to make everyday job easier, and to be aware of the limitations and know workarounds. Spock and Groovy work hard to make writing tests easier, and it provides, on the surface, the specification is compact, readable, easy to maintain, but there are multiple nooks and crannies available in Spock for advanced users. So dive into Spock, learn it well, and use smartly to deliver software that both you and the users will be satisfied with. And yeah, and that's all I have today. Thank you. We have 1 minute for questions. But I do not expect any question after the number of questions which you asked during the presentation. Okay, one question. They will be available. I will tweet about that and probably send to the organizers then. Yes. Okay, maybe other question. We have a half minute. If not, I will be here after presentation. I'm here until tomorrow, so feel free to ask me personally or via email, Twitter, and so on. Thank you once again.